Whenever you see a headline that says something is on the rise, there are basically two possibilities. One, the thing is actually on the rise, like pickleball. The other possibility is that we're capturing the information differently nowadays. Either we're getting better at measuring something that's always been common. Autism spectrum disorder may fall in this category, at least for part of the observed increase. Or we're measuring that thing worse, with more false positives driving up the observed rate, like UFO sightings. Ubiquitous phone cameras mean every little bit of swamp gas from a weather balloon trapped in a thermal pocket and reflecting the light from Venus gets recorded. So it's the job of epidemiologists to figure out what is driving observed changes in our health. And this week, I want to share some data that shows that the rate of a specific cannabis-associated problem is not just on the rise, it is absolutely skyrocketing. Let's see if we can figure out why. This week, we're talking about Cannabis Hyperemesis Syndrome, CHS, a once rare condition characterized by cyclic episodes of what can be intractable vomiting. The exact physiology of CHS is still being worked out, but it probably has something to do with chronic exposure downregulating cannabinoid receptors in the gut, leading to decreased gut motility. But regardless of how exactly this works, the numbers suggest it's becoming dramatically more common, at least among adolescents, as highlighted in this research letter appearing in JAMA Network Open. Researchers interrogated the Pediatric Health Information System database, which collates data from 52 freestanding children's hospitals around the U.S. They were looking for adolescents admitted to the emergency room with diagnostic codes consistent with CHS, typically a chief complaint of nausea and vomiting, and at least a second diagnostic code indicating a cannabis-related concern. These could be things like cannabis abuse or dependence. The time frame of interest was 2016 to 2023. Let's just take a look at the raw numbers. To give you some perspective, in 2006, there were 6.8 ED visits for CHS per 1 million population. In 2016, the start of this study, that number had jumped to 160.4, a more than 23-fold increase over a decade. Those rates increased around 40% per year through 2023. The most recent data showed around 2,000 visits for CHS per million population. That's a 30,000% increase in less than 20 years. Crazy numbers. But are they real? Remember, when we see the rate of anything going up, we need to make sure we're not measuring it differently. And I certainly have some concern here that we are potentially unmasking a problem that has been there all along, but not well documented until recently. I mean, adolescents show up in the ER all the time for nausea and vomiting. The AHRQ publishes some of this data, actually. For example, in 2018, there were nearly 800,000 visits for nausea and vomiting among those under age 18, about 2.5% of all ER visits. The question is, how many of those had CHS? The study we're discussing this week would call it CHS if, in addition to the nausea and vomiting, they had a secondary code for a cannabis-related issue. I have no doubt that we use those codes more frequently now. For one thing, the broad-scale decriminalization and legalization of marijuana has removed much of the stigma that existed in the early 2000s. Doctors might be less worried about outing these kids nowadays. Another possibility is that knowledge of cannabis hyperemesis syndrome is spreading. With more marijuana use, doctors are getting more sensitive to the diagnosis. So perhaps some of those things we used to call a stomach bug now get appropriately diagnosed as CHS. Now, of course, the converse could also be true. Since we're more comfortable adding cannabis-associated diagnosis codes now than we used to be in the past, we may currently be misclassifying people with nausea from another cause as CHS. Like, just because you have cannabis use disorder or cannabis dependence doesn't mean you're not allowed to get norovirus. Of course, the other possibility is that there's a lot more marijuana use going on, and with that, more cannabis hyperemesis syndrome. The authors hypothesize that if that were the case, you might see a more dramatic rise in states that have legalized recreational marijuana use. And this is where the data gets a bit weird, because yes, states with recreational marijuana legalization had higher levels of ER visits for CHS, overall about 1,900 cases per million versus 800 cases per million, but the rate of growth of those visits was more dramatic in states without recreational marijuana legalization. The authors don't opine on what would cause this pattern of observations, and that's probably wise, since the data is relatively limited. But that has never stopped me before, so here's what I think is going on. I think a lot of this is real. I suspect there's a true increase in the amount of cannabis hyperemesis syndrome that is commensurate with the broader availability of marijuana in the marketplace. This leads to higher rates in states that have legalized recreational marijuana use. But a significant proportion of the observed increase is due to uncovering CHS in people who would not have received the diagnosis in the past and misclassification of non-CHS syndromes in the setting of people who just happen to use marijuana. And this occurs in states without legalized marijuana because, let's face it, even in those states, the stigma about marijuana use is just nowhere near what it was 10 or 20 years ago. The times, they are changing, as one former pothead noted. Is this all a problem? CHS can be bad. In fact, just under half of the kids in the study required a hospital admission. A bit under 1% required the intensive care unit. That said, we should still contextualize these ER visits in the context of other risks adolescents face. I pulled a bit of data comparing ER visits for CHS to those for depression, suicide, gun violence, and drug overdoses. You can see here that CHS rates aren't as high as, say, ER visits for suicidal behavior, but these are all in the same ballpark. Of course, that's assuming the numbers in the study are not inflated. Still, it seems like we can add cannabis hyperemesis syndrome to the list of real risks adolescents face in the U.S. today. And if growth rates of the syndrome continue, as they did in this study, rising by 50% per year, well, we can assume every American adolescent will be in the ER for CHS by 2040. Okay, that would be unlikely. But I suppose we can keep a bloodshot eye on it. For Medscape, I'm Perry Wilson.